See, that's why I actually, I'm not a master of PowerPoint presentations, and I, in general, I avoid using technology because there's always something, right? But I scanned some scores for you, and I thought that was really important, and when I learned that there will be so many of you, I thought I'll have handouts, but then they say, well, 105 people. I said, that would be a lot of trees. So so that's how I went. I chose to do the scan. So. It stirs our imagination what the conductor does, and I'm thrilled to share that with you because I don't really have an opportunity to tell, you know, to share these details about my passion, and so the main part of my presentation will be about how this book with notes in it, how does that, you know, what's the process from there to the actual performance. But before we get there, a few introductory notes. Conductor versus music director. So a conductor is obviously the person who comes and conducts the performance. Music director is also the conductor, but it's his most important duty. But there are others. A music director of an orchestra or an opera or a chorus is responsible for, you know, helping to choose musicians, create an artistic vision for the organization, help with fundraising, which became an absolute necessity in the last few decades for conductors. And it was a new skill that we had to learn that the old maestros didn't have to. We have to create programs. And we are the face of the organization. That's why, you know, I really don't take it personally that you came here. I think you like classical music, and it just so happened that conductors are always, you know, we have to have someone that represents it. So that's what we do. So music director is a very rich job, one I had to learn. Because that's not what they teach you in school. And coming from Europe, that's twice so true, because in Europe, you usually don't do any fundraising. The music director is the guy who conducts and prepares programs and deals with all things musical, but nothing really outside of music, which sounds great. But let me tell you, being a music director in America, it has that wonderful effect that you really have a say in how the organization is going to look going forward. I have a significantly more power upon how things will look, and so it's a lot of work, but you can see your contribution. Whereas in Europe, often you're just one wheel, maybe the most visible wheel, but nevertheless one of many wheels in the organization, and so that brings, of course, you know, some frustrations, and it's a little more difficult environment. On the other hand, you only concentrate on your scores. So, with having clarified that, you know, when I go guest conduct, I'm a guest conductor there. It's kind of a wonderful situation because you fly in and. You know, you are presented with these musicians, and that's what you got. So you don't have to worry about, you know, of course you're trying to have them do their best, but you don't have to deal with personal issues. You don't have to think, well, I think that player will need a replacement in 2 years. So you just fly in, you are nice, you push them, you make a concert, and you get on a plane, and you're out. So which it's a nice situation. However, most of conductors eventually land a job or actually strive to land a job as a music director, because then you can settle. You can, for change, have your own home. And in the long term, as I said, I mean, to me, it's a tremendous satisfaction to be able to shape an organization and leave something behind, something more tangible than just a single concert. So. One of the duties, and I'm going to now concentrate on the musical aspect of my job, because that's why you're here, and that's what this presentation is about. The music director chooses repertoire. Now, I actually have a committee in this particular orchestra because I like to have a feedback. And so I invite selected musicians and board members and some people from community at large to critique me when I'm done with my season. But first thing, how do you program a concert? Well, there are many different different ways how you can make a successful concert. You can make an all Beethoven concert. You can make an all 19th century concert. You can make a concert of works that are all in G major, which probably is not the greatest idea. It just so happened that it became a norm to have a soloist at a concert, but it's an unwritten rule, and there may be concerts without a soloist, there may be concerts with multiple soloists, that structure that you usually see when you go to a symphony concert anywhere in the world, which is something short in the beginning, then a concerto with a soloist, and then a symphony in a second half, is also a relatively new phenomenon. As I realized when I did some research and read programs of the New York Philharmonic from early 20th century, and they varied so widely, and they were so much more, in a way, interesting and adventurous as the programs you see today. Sometimes you would have just two works or one work. Sometimes you would have eight works or nine works, and they would combine. They would not be afraid to play one movement of a concerto, and then followed by a operetta, you know, a number with a soloist, and then do a little orchestral piece. And so there was a lot of variety. Now, were they always coherent? You know, when you go to a concert, you expect something coherent. At least I like to think that. I mean, that's how I program my works. So they were not always all that coherent. They were often just ad hoc. It seemed to me like, okay, well, these people were available, so that's what we're doing. But so when I create programs, I try to make it work. As you know from my program notes, if you read them, I try to make always these works work together. Sometimes it's very simple and very obvious. So, say if you do works that have to do with spring or works that have to do with water or something, you know, basic like that. You know, you can see the common thread. But often what makes these works work together is not really, I cannot really express it well in words, because I not only want them to be alike, I also want them to offer contrast. But so they have to work together, but they also have to balance each other. And then, of course, there's that issue of offering different kind of challenges and different kind of experiences for you each time you come to a concert. One of the comments that I value most, and I've heard quite a few times from our audiences this past season, was like, "Wow!" Was saying, "Wow, every concert is completely different," and that's what I strive to do. I strive to give you different different experiences every time you come to a concert. So I think there are, and sometimes you think also in terms of a season. For example, I open the season with a piece, and I close season with a piece that is linked to it somehow. Like my first season, I opened with Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, and finished with Brahms' First Symphony, and there are many links between these two works. So in my mind, it sort of creates a bridge and makes a coherent whole. Now, so what goes into specifically into repertoire choosing? Well, it's my own interests, and I don't think it's selfish, because you want me to present works that I believe in and that I feel strongly about. But it's also the needs of the orchestra. You get to know your orchestra, if you're not guest conducting, obviously, and you know what really fits them, what not, and also what do they need to work on. And so there are projects that I have in mind that I would like to do, but I believe that we need to take several steps to get there. So for example, next season, I'm very excited that the symphony will be doing a symphony by Gustav Mahler. And I waited for you know, this will be my fourth season, so I waited 3.5 years to tackle that challenge, because I thought we have to go through different other steps that would get us there. And then, of course, you come to an orchestra and you may find out that you have a fabulous first flute player. So, for example, in this case, it led me to schedule the prelude of The Afternoon of the Faun by Debussy, which has an extensive flute solo in the beginning. And if you don't have that player, if you don't really believe that it's an exceptional player, then you schedule something else. You need to know your orchestra, and I also take a feedback from the orchestra, and they come up with great and interesting ideas, and I try to incorporate them. And then, of course, audience sensibilities and preferences. Will my programs here be different than programs in Slovakia? Yes, they will be different. There will be more, not only that there will be more American music here and more maybe Slovakian music over there, but it's just, you know, we all have carry our cultural traditions with us, and so certain types of music speak to us more than others, and it differs to a degree in different areas of the world. Now, also, one of my jobs, I believe, is to take you on a journey. When I got this job, and this goes back to multiple season programming, actually, when I was auditioning, I got a question from the search committee, we don't see any contemporary works on your programs. Why is that? And I said, well, that's intentional. It's not that I don't want to do them, but I think that they are very challenging. It's a very challenging music often, and you need the audience to be on your side. You need the audience to trust the conductor in his musical selection. So I said, on purpose, my first season will be very populistic, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I need you to like me and to trust me. And then step by step, every season gets a little more challenging. And it's an exciting journey, and sometimes this past season, the concert number 4 was, I thought, quite adventurous. And so I was a little, you know, I was worried about how you will receive it. And if I would get a very negative feedback, I would change my plans in the future, and I would maybe, you know, go around something, or maybe I would just take a slower approach. So I do listen to a feedback from the audience, and luckily, for example, that concert, many people just seemed to love it. So I was encouraged, and so I would like to take you to a next step, just so that you can discover a new corner of this vast universe that is classical music. So all these things come together when creating a season or multiple seasons. I am in my plannings. I'm usually a few years ahead. My 14-15 season is already. I already have the soloists in my mind and most of the works in my mind. And I already have plans for 2 years ahead and 3 years ahead. It's also, when you want to get good soloists, you have to plan ahead. Then there is also an aspect, I want to bring some people back, but I don't want to bring them back right away. I feel that you have a right to see a variety of people, so I always wait, usually at least 3 years before I bring someone back. Even if it was a very popular person, I am very, very hesitant to make an exception to the rule. There are other great artists, and we should know those too. Working with orchestra. So, musicianship. Yeah, that's an obvious one, right? And we, as conductors, we train for many years, often, you know, 15, 20 years before we are, you know, even able to tackle that profession, because you have to be a quite a complex musician. You have to know, you don't have to play every instrument, obviously that would be impossible, but you should play something or sing and be able to prove yourself as a musician. I think that's very important. But I need to know in theory how the instruments work, what sounds good, what sounds bad, learn about the techniques, and then there's then that intangible thing of are you able to recreate what the score offers in an exciting way so that people respond to it, and that's something that can partially be learned. I think something that comes from the experience. I sure hope that I'm getting better as a musician, but it's also the you have to have certain talent for that. And but being a conductor doesn't only mean being a very good musician. I have met many great musicians who wanted to be conductors, and they just didn't have the right kind of personality. For example, they were very introverted. So they came in front of the orchestras. They had these great ideas, but they could not project. I mean, it's as simple as they would come and they got mediocre results. So you would think that those people would be fantastic, but you have to be able to be a leader, and being a leader in a very general sense. And that leads me to my second point, psychology. And that's also what makes my job so incredibly interesting, because you're always wondering how to achieve the results with in the quickest possible way, but also in the smoothest possible way. And those are not always the same thing. Now, I heard several comments at the dress rehearsal. We had a few folks visiting at the dress rehearsal, and I've heard, wow, you're very strict with them. Well, that it can give you, you can get a wrong kind of impression. When we're in a dress rehearsal situation, so first of all, every time I stop the orchestra, I lose 30 to 60 seconds. And time is money, and that we have only so much rehearsal time. So what I often do, I will not stop, and I will address problems as we go. So something happens over there, I conduct, the music goes on, and I look, and I yell, I shout. Because otherwise, they don't hear me. You would not believe, I have a pretty strong voice, you would not believe how often, you know, I yell something at woodwinds, and I see... So you have to be loud, but you also cannot you cannot be overly nice. We don't have time for, would you please mind to the... I mean, this has to happen in a matter of seconds. So I yell at them, piano! And they know, hopefully, that I'm not a mean person, that, you know, I'm trying to use our time effectively. Now, if I would only do that, they would eventually get an impression that I'm an oppressive human being. So from time to time, you know, I like to work very intensely and stop and address things quickly and and don't let people lose a concentration, go back and start playing right away and leave very little time, so that we are sort of in this really heightened state of concentration. But then you realize, hopefully, you do realize that people are getting tired. I mean, you have to realize when people start making mistakes that are, you know, they shouldn't be making. So then there is time when you stop and you say a story or you say a joke, preferably not about one of the musicians. Preferably not even about one of the, one of the instruments. Because everyone will be laughing but that one person. And then next time you make the joke, everyone will be laughing but two people, and soon nobody's going to laugh. So I think the best way is actually to... I like to make self-depreciating jokes from time to time so that they see that I am, you know, that seriousness of intent doesn't mean that I am angry at them. You know, it's very easy to get that impression because there is no buffer between the conductor and the orchestra. We don't have several layers of command, right? Like you're a CEO of a company and you're unhappy with somebody's work, and you tell the second in command, and then that tells the third person, and then the fourth person goes to that person and says, you know, the boss, you know how he is, but this is what he said. It's very different. I mean, I always tell them directly. So, and then I have to tell you, musicians are very sensitive human beings. They are, if you want them to create art, if you want them to really give their best, they have to make themselves vulnerable to, they have to open their souls. And when you ask people to do that and then you stab them, it's they will close and they will never give you the same kind of, they will never give you the best. They will never give you their sincere feelings in the music. And I know it because I was on the other side. And I know that, you know, you trust the conductor, you want to give them the best, and then he or she says something that makes you close, and you will not open to that person again, certainly not for that concert. So it leads to some interesting situations. Say somebody makes a mistake. Am I going to stop and say, you made a mistake? Well, probably not, because most likely that person knows that he or she made a mistake. So I only have to make an eye contact with the person, and I see if the person looks at me, you see, okay, he knows, I know, we no need to stop, no need to address it. Now, say you are not so sure if the person knew. Say that somebody played out of tune and wasn't sure, you don't think that he or she was aware of that. So what do you do then? Well, so that all depends on situation, but also it depends on a human being. Some of us are more fragile, and some of us, when you scare someone, they will perform, even they will become, you know, they will start feeling, they will feel fear, and they will just perform even worse. So it leads to an interesting situation that, for example, I hear somebody having a problem with a difficult section. And instead of addressing it, I will wait for the proper moment, and I will stop and address something else, something neutral, say a balance issue. So I say, so something that is not personal. Brass, play real true piano here because you're all overpowering strings. Let's go back to letter C. And I give that person a chance to play that solo again without even looking at that person or acknowledging that there was a problem. You have to use all kinds of psychological tools to get the best result. And it's a true art that I will keep learning for the rest of my life. And that is a huge part of my profession. You know, if the musicianship is 50%, psychology maybe 40%. It's very important. And sometimes people who don't, you know, people who are musicians but don't really understand the dynamics of working with the orchestra, they'll come to me and say, why didn't you tell that person? You know, they were playing out of tune. Yeah, well, you have a list of problems. There are 100 problems. I have to decide on a spot which problems I have to solve right away, which problems I will solve on rehearsal 2 or 3, and which I don't have to deal with because they will fix themselves. And so often I will leave certain things, and I will absolutely not comment on them, although to a layman ear, those would be the most blatant mistakes. But that's also what they know. So they will come, and they will be better prepared next time, and I don't have to stop and waste my 30 seconds. So it's a fascinating part of my job. And that's why when you're a young conductor, you're an assistant conductor, and you go to rehearsals and you try to learn how the great ones do it. I'm a strong believer that if you want to ask people to work hard, you have to work hard yourself. So my orchestra knows that I come really prepared for my rehearsals. I spend many, many hours on my scores, and then that's why I can demand and I can ask them to do things. If I would come prepared generally so and say, you guys have to practice, it would just not have the same effect. So it always, I want to be always in a position that I can ask them to work hard. So I have to work a little harder than them. Time management is another important element, how you structure your rehearsals. When you're in a guest conducting situation, they ask you for a breakdown of your rehearsals. So, and there are some unwritten rules that we usually follow, unless you have a good reason to disobey them. The rehearsal usually starts with the biggest work. So we're not going in a concert order until the dress rehearsal. I always start with the biggest work, which often is the symphony, but not always. Even within that work, I will not necessarily start with the first movement and then move on to the second movement. You want to start with something that sort of makes them warm up and tune in. Then you tackle something really challenging. Then you do something, you know, that requires less stopping and more just playing through. Then you take a break. After break, you again tackle something challenging. So it's you're just shuffling these things, and I have to do that ahead of time because my orchestra requires that they like to know when are they going to be needed, and they want to know it ahead of time. So it's usually at least a week before the first rehearsal that I send out a detailed schedule. Okay, this piece from 8:25 to 8:55, so that some people, because it's not as simple, you know. Sometimes you would have a biggest orchestration in a symphony, but then you would have an overture that has some unusual instrument that is not featured in the symphony. So that person only has to come for that other piece, and you don't want them to be there at 7 if they're not needed until 8:20. That's not a good time management. And as much as I'm trying to combine works that have similar orchestration to make this as small of a problem as possible, it's just impossible to always schedule works that have the same orchestration, and it wouldn't be even desirable. But I also don't want to schedule a piece that uses half of the orchestra and then the piece that uses the whole orchestra, because then I have to pay everyone the same money, and we're just not getting a good use of their time. So. So that's a few elements that go into structuring the rehearsal. And oh, I think I just mentioned this, scheduling a rehearsal, how that process works. Okay, so now before we see the scores, something about conducting technique. We have usually two hands, and most of conductors use the right hand, even when they're left-handed. They use the right hand to show patterns, conducting patterns, beating patterns. Why don't left-handed conductors use left hand? They do sometimes, but often not. Because the musicians are so used from their peripheral vision to see that this hand doing something and this hand doing something else, that if you switch them, it creates confusion and you lose time. You want to concentrate on music and not anything extra musical. So, right hand beating patterns. Here's some basic beating patterns. That beating pattern in two looks like a three, but it's really this. If you look, one, two, you're basically doing a little inverted J. Say, or U, although the hand never goes up to the position of one. Okay, the most important thing, the first beat in every measure goes down, and that's how they count measures. So whatever I'm doing, they count measures. So there is a timpanist waiting, and she has 78 measures of nothing, and then she has ba-dum! And you would think, well, yeah, she's just going to listen. Well, we're all in a space, and they don't necessarily hear the entire picture. They don't hear it as well as you guys do. And often, they only would hear mumbling. You know, they hear, say, strings doing, and all of a sudden, ba-dum. Well, where is that? You need a conductor for that. And they all appreciate if you can show that. So this is what's going on. Always, this is, and every conductor does that. Hand goes vertically down. That's our one. And so when the music goes in two, such as in 2-4, 2-2, I will not go into those theoretical details. When the music requires to beat in two, then you do 1-2, 1-2. When the music requires you to beat in three, then you do a triangle. One goes down, two goes out, three goes up. Last beat of every measure goes up, obviously, since one has to go down. If it's a four, then one goes down, then you go in, then you go out, then you go up. And now these are universally known schemes. That's how every conductor works, every conductor. Now, there's exceptions to rules, and yes, there will be instances when there will be one, and I will be doing this instead of doing this for musical reasons, and I will do it when I know that it will not confuse them. But these are the rules. And so we all do it differently because we have different physiques, but we will always strive to have one down, and we will always in 4-4 go in and out and up. In a 6-beat pattern, you go down, out, out, in, out, out, up. And in 9, you go down, da 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 da. So you switch that place, that space, and so it looks pretty trivial, like anyone could do it, and yet, but it does look very simple. But it takes years. It takes years and a good mirror too, because you have to. We often fool ourselves. We think we're very clear. What usually happens, when I have a conducting student, any conductor, we always have a tendency to use this space way more than use this space. So if you're not careful, you will end up doing this, and you will think that you're doing this. You know? So it's good to be able to check, especially when you're a young conductor. Also, there are certain rules. What distinguishes a good conductor from a mediocre or bad conductor? I believe that the roots of this all is actually you have to be. We're mimicking nature. We're trying to be as natural as possible. This movement reflects so many things. It reflects a string player doing this. It reflects a wind player or a singer doing. It reflects, in its broadest terms, it's just a matter of gravity, you know, dropping a ball, boom, you know, boom. So there is the momentum, you know, the movement speeds up as you're hitting that imaginary plate, and then it bounces off and slows down a little bit, and then it goes back and speeds up and bounces back up, right? So good conductors are easy to look at because it's so natural, because it reflects nature, and that's why anyone can go and say, wow, that's beautiful conducting. Well, because we know these kind of movements from our surroundings. As I said, we try to have an imaginary platform that we use. So when I go 1, 2, 3, 4, see, it's all on the same platform. And then there's also variations to that. For example, if I want a really deep sound, if I want heavy sound, I will move that platform lower, and I will beat here, you know, just to give an inspiration for that sound. Now, if you want something very ethereal and fluffy, you may start doing it here. Also, say there are sections where strings and winds respond to each other. So I may choose to conduct here for strings and then use a different plate here for winds and then go back here and make it very obvious to them, you know, what do you expect from that music. So it takes years, And then when you think you know it, then you always find some new challenge. Another thing that often happens, all practically always, with young conductors, and we all have to go through it, is that you practice, and you think you know what you're doing. You come in front of the orchestra, and you realize there is always this little delay in a response of the orchestra. So when I do 1, 2, 3, 4, the music goes ba di ba di da di da da, and it's consistent, and it's not the same with each orchestra. Some orchestras are known to go way behind the beat. That's how we call it, like Vienna Philharmonic or St. Petersburg, go way behind the beat, but they come together. It's and frankly, I don't have a good explanation. There's something that is in the tradition of the orchestra and that each new player become somehow part of, and that's just how they react. In my experience, I noticed, actually you stop noticing it after a while, but when I was younger, it seemed to me that radio orchestras that do a lot of recordings and they have different conductors every week and they have to be able to react very fast, that they have the least amount of delay. And traditional symphony orchestras, it seemed to me, had way more delay. Because they need to be able to read your intention. And they also react differently to different conductors, because, you know, as much as we try to make this universal, it varies wildly, as you well know. So, beating patterns, right hand. Sometimes we do mirror. There's nothing wrong with that, but you just don't want to do it for too long. But most of the time, the left hand is used for all these other things. Cueing. So as I said, there is this timpani waiting for 78 measures, and then you do pew, and she plays. Sometimes you don't have to do it. There are many, many cues that you guys don't see because I am not making them obvious, because there's no need for that. All I need to do is look their direction, exactly the right moment before they come in. And it encourages them. They're most of the time absolutely sure when they should come. But it's still good to have that reassurance and that, you know, welcome, join us. It's your time. So many, many things just happen with the, you know, through eyes. Now, some players get really nervous when you look at them. So then I don't. When I learn that, I don't, but I will do this. I will face away, and I will do... It works better. If I know it freaks them out that they have a big solo, then I will make sure I will not look at them. Often when a big solo comes, and every musician's nervous, of course, I try to smile. I smile at them, and you know, just, hey, it's gonna be fine. But some of them don't see me. Some of them just, before their solo comes, it just whoosh. You know, you see a screen just going down, and you know, there's the only thing they will see is, oh my God, he's looking at me. Oh my God, he's looking at me. Am I late already? Am I late? So in that case, ignore it, just point and pretend you're not listening. So we're cueing with the left hand, which is particularly important in opera. In opera, again, this, and many people are surprised that when I'm in the pit, I'm actually leading the singers as well, not just the orchestra. Leading opera is the most demanding thing for every conductor because there are so many elements and everyone reacts differently. Also, what we have to realize, again, those singers, they don't often hear the music or they hear very little of it and they are in a constant movement. So if a singer runs upstage and the orchestra doesn't play fortissimo, all they hear their breath and then they hear... They don't hear music. I'm sorry to say, they know the music, they internalize the music, so the music keeps playing in their mind. But with that movement, they can be off by a beat easily. So that's why we have to be there, and that's why I'm there and I'm cueing them. And you may have noticed me or other conductors doing this. You know, if I know that the singer made the run and made it faster than yesterday, there is a chance that it's going to be a disaster. So my hand goes up, and you know, if they don't look, they will hear from me, and they will look next time. But but so they see that, and they will wait for the cue. So cueing, alerting, hey, it's coming up. Watch out. Sometimes you see a musician who, for some reason, is just blanking. And you see that, and that's why I like to conduct without a score, because I can see all that. And I see that, oh, a solo's coming, and the instrument is on the floor. Say it's a trombone. That's all it takes. Oh. So you have to be aware of all that. So you're alerting them. You're telling them not or yes. Of course, more and less. These are very just fun, you know. Just very, it's a universal language that will not never fail you, except in Bulgaria. Well, do you know that Bulgaria is the only country in the world where this is no, and this is yes, which is just incredibly confusing. Because it happens, you don't think about it all the time. Hey, may I sit next to you? You know, you shake your hand, I mean, before you think. It's okay because they understand that they are exposed to people from other countries. So I think they developed the ability to be on alert. But I got confused a few times when I was like, okay, I just explained something, understand? And they're like, and I'm like, why are they? They're not buying into it. They're not happy with me. So the same. I was worried. You know, I conduct sometimes and say they're doing a crescendo and I want them to do more. And I start encouraging them. You know, yes, give me more. Yes, give me more. And you just hope they will not think like, oh no, you suck. See, I cannot do it. So. But apart from that, you should be fine with all these gestures. You know, I think in every culture, this is stop and not go. Alerting, emphasizing. Emphasizing meaning, yes, more or less. But it also means, you know, when I go like this, I want them to play legato. Say, I want more legato. I can show that. Or I can do this to get more staccato. And now, why would I have to do that? Is it because we didn't rehearse enough? No. It's because every day is different. That's the beauty of live performance. And every hole is different. So what worked in Medford doesn't necessarily work in Grants Pass. And we start playing the same passage, and I realize the fragment of second that it's too dry for this hole. So I go this, you know, because they don't have that feedback that I do, that I have. So that's why you adjust these things on spot. And the better musicians you have, the more they're able to pick up on these things. And the quicker they can react, and that's the whole fun when you have a really good orchestra, and you can just play, and you can change things. You don't have to necessarily do everything the way you did it in a rehearsal, but you can, you know, you feel like wow, he took a really good breath and he can stretch that ritardando more. Let me give him more time. I can adjust these things, and that's. That's the greatest thrill, and that's the great thrill of having really accomplished musicians. Inspiring. Well, that's everything else, right? And we don't only inspire with the left hand, obviously. That, you know, there's so many gestures we cannot really explain. People doing, or I don't know, shaking in weird ways, or you know. Doing all kinds of things, and we all have our idiosyncrasies, and somehow, in the heat of the moment, they translate beautifully. You know, one of the prominent stars of our era, Russian conductor Gergiev, his technique is almost, I almost cannot follow his patterns or anything, and yet the orchestra understands, and I understand, and I would follow him perfectly, although he just does a lot of shaking and... Anyway, I think it's like being an abstract painter. If you want to be an abstract painter, you I believe you should be able to know how to draw a hand and draw a head that actually resembles a real person. And then when you go and do that one dot, it will be a very different dot than as if somebody untrained like me comes and makes that dot. I think that really, if you filter your entire experience into that one shake, it will be a different shake. Score study, here we are. So first of all, we're going to look at, I scanned several of my scores because I want to share with you what is it that I mark into them, you know, what's important for a conductor to add to the music that's on page. And the first piece we're going to deal with is Beethoven Symphony No. 5. Before we do that, let me get us online and show you a few examples of the beginning of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. We'll comment on it and we'll take it from there. So, okay, here's an example number one. This is Paavo Järvi, an Estonian conductor, I believe. And I don't know how strong the sound will be. This is on max. But it's mostly about seeing the gestures. I don't know if anyone can make this louder. I sure cannot. Okay. I think there's probably on this panel. Yeah, volume. Yeah. Oh, great. Great. Thank you. So I'll go back to the beginning. Okay, thank you. So conductor number one. Just watch his entire body language, not just his hands. Enough. Gustavo Dudamel. You already like him. Okay, moving on. These two are not longer there. I checked yesterday, so let's move on to. Do you remember Bernstein when he had the beard?
Yeah.
Well, I think it's late 70s, maybe up until 1980. Let me move forward with this a little bit. This one will be too loud. Notice how much more time he takes before he start than the first conductor, who just jumped on stage and started conducting. Way slower. Notice what he does with his hands going on these long notes. He likes them. He wants them to inspire them to sustain the sound. No decrescendo. So that's why pip 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 ah, and he keeps that. It's a fermata. He should stop according to a book, but he keeps moving up slowly to sustain the sound. So next one. Arturo Toscanini, a great master of early 20th century. Okay. Doesn't shake the concertmaster's hand. Very concise and, you know, business first. But a few things about this. I looked at the beginning of I looked at this a few times. I don't know how they start. I don't understand. There is a missing beat, and yet they start together. But what we have to realize, he had an amazing amount of rehearsal time, and he was famous for being quite dictatorial. So he probably could have just done this, and they would start playing. So that's he trained his orchestra to do exactly what he wanted, even if he didn't really give them what he should have given them. And this is, I don't mean it by any means as a critique. Also, Arturo Toscanini was the one that is credited for starting the trend of conducting without the score. But he had different reasons than when we do. He couldn't see well. His vision was very bad, so he had to memorize those scores. And then many conductors, and me including, we feel like we should do that. But it's and then we get critiqued. Sometimes people say, well, why do you do that? Why do you conduct without the score? Do you really know every note and every dot in every moment that it's being played? And I said, no, do you when you conduct with the score? You don't. You scan. You scan pages as you go looking for important information. All the detailed work happened before. And yes, it's all there, but in the heat of the moment, that's not really important. It's really not important to know if the note C is doubled 700 times in that one chord or 500 times. It's just, that's not my job. My job is to help the musician to create a sound that I want them to. So I believe first of all, when I memorize a score, it really forces me to learn it way, just much more, much deeper, to learn its structure, because I need to know so much about it to have all these connections that are, you know, you have to have layers and layers of connections. It takes many, many hours. But also it allows me to be free and to watch the musicians and see what they need. And that's, I think that's important. So that's why I try to conduct all the big symphonies by heart. Okay, Claudio Abbado, conducting number 5. Now, as a curiosity, we can see a little bit of Muti. Riccardo Muti is now a chief conductor of the Chicago Symphony. Let me just move it forward. Oh, too late. Sorry about that. I guess I didn't really gain anything. Unfortunately, we will not see his hands. Okay, and now as a curiosity, there is this Okay, stop. You can stop now. I don't know why he's doing it. Anyway, as a curiosity, there's a Japanese conductor. There are many good Japanese conductors. This one is not. But he seems to have kind of a following. I think he's a legend, probably mostly in his own mind. But I'll let you judge for yourself what's happening here. Masato Usuki is his name. It's not a good quality video, but it's worth seeing. He comes in with a lot of dignity and oh yeah. Old bard. So now watch this. So once again, please someone explain to me when to start playing. It's worth watching. Now. And he keeps going like that. I mean, he's not giving the tempo or anything. It's very funny, and he's very intense. I'll give him that. But so we you see it's the tempos differ, the lengths of pa pa pa, how long those notes are, differ. Their expression differs, and their philosophy about conducting differs. You know, should I be the one who is inspiring the emotion in players, or should I be the one who's almost invisible and let them play and be as little present as possible? So now with this in mind, let me show you first page of my score of this symphony. And I don't know how well you can see. Well, not very well. I made color scans with an intention to show you. So first of all, the first thing I do when I get a score, I sit down at the piano and I play through it. Now see, the music moves in time like this. So, right here. Da 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 da. See, this is on the bottom we have a string section. Here we have brass and percussions, and over there we have woodwinds. So you also have two bassoons playing ta ti ta ti ta. So, as a conductor, you're always following the action, going like this. Now there are several notes, and some of them you don't see well, and it's too bad because I chose this score because I did it multiple times, and so there are different layers of from my different. Times when I was conducting it. One of the big changes that I that happened with me in the course of the years, I switched from a black pencil to red pencil. It's because I can see much better with red. So all my older notes, as you will see on the next pages, are in black. All my newer notes are in red. So what I mark here on this particular page, and this is frankly a reminder, I would not have to do it with this symphony, but it gets me in the zone. Dynamics, fortissimo, fermata, piano, violas, there's a VLE that you cannot see, first violin. And so I have different signs for every instrument. So if it's a first trumpet, I will write TR1. For some instruments, I use German abbreviations because when you have trumpets, trombones, it's all both TR. So I actually use Posaunen, POS, for trombones. I use FG, that's from German Fagotten, for bassoons, because BS also could mean basses. Although for basses, I use contrabassi. Anyway, so I try to make them... I try to make them instantly recognizable. For timpani, sometimes some of these signs are graphic. So for timpani, I use two sticks that are crossed like this. So and this is partially my individual choices, but also any other conductor could recognize these signs. They're different variations, and some of them I picked up over the years when I looked at scores of other people and realized, oh, I really like this sign. Or sometimes, you know, you would have a brass section coming together, and I will mark it with a big sign like this. But I will only use it for brass. I will never use it for woodwinds entrance. So you kind of develop this language, which is quite individual. But most of conductors would be able to read it. So see the next page. The next page is two systems, actually. So the music continues. Ta 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 tim dam dam di 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 da. And then it comes here, but it still moves like this. See? And instruments are being added as we go. I'm hoping some of those other scans will have little better markings. But see, I emphasize certain things, crescendo. Always in every score you find mistakes. So, for example, here I see that they were asked to do sforzando, SF, on every. However, these instruments only had forte, so I add little S, so because it must be unified in this, you know. So I also check this course, and okay, let's see if there's anything. What you totally cannot see, I can see it here. Maybe if we could make it darker. Maybe if we could make it darker. I don't know if it would help. But do you see anything here? No, it's still not visible. There are all kinds of signs. There are chords, chord analysis. So I know exactly that this chord is this and this and this. And again, in this notoriously known piece, it's more of a mental exercise for me. But often I go through a score and there's an interesting modulation. I say, oh, I don't quite see it right from the bat what happens there. So I analyze it and write it down. I write big harmonies, important changes. I don't know. We probably couldn't get more contrast. But maybe some other score will work better. Horn. Big horn call, but again, you don't see it very well. I'm just trying to, and all these harmonies, you don't really see it. You don't see that there is a letter A above, and there's bar numbers that I added because this particular score didn't have it. So it takes many hours and repeating, going back and forth. And every time I go, I add a new layer of information there. And this is before I ever raise my hand. It is a lot of notes. So again, some of these signs are for dynamics. Some of these signs are for our cues for instruments. I don't know. Maybe it would be interesting for you to hear the music and follow few pages of the score. What do you say? Shall we try that? Let's do that. I think that'd be. I'll I'll get off this presentation and we'll not use this guy. we can use Muti because he's just the closest here. So hold on, he's all wired. He wanna start, but I first have to get back to my presentation. So how to do this? Hold on. Don't play. Okay. I failed. Hold on, but I'm gonna figure it out. I'm smart enough. Maybe if I, oh, I see. Okay, I think I figured it out. Oh, damn you. Okay, I'll find it quickly. Well, this is not really working. Okay. Horns, bassoons and oboes, woodwinds. Now fortissimo. Horns. Strings. Clarinet solo. Flute solo with first violins. First violins alone. This motif keeps going on in the cellos and basses. Build up crescendo. Fortissimo. Violins carry on the melody. Clarinets join. All woodwinds. Now he went back, okay. Okay, so, this was intense. Oh. But hopefully it gave you a little appreciation how fast these things, thank you. How fast these things happen and how many different things you have to watch. And I was not able to give you everything, obviously, but that's how we follow the score. And that's where my ears tune in. See, when violins go, and I'm listening and I'm judging and I'm evaluating, but at the same time, I'm already looking at clarinets and see if they're really blending into the sound with the same melody. And then somewhere along here, I'll raise my head to look at woodwinds and make sure they breathe together and they really play this motif together. And so that's how you go throughout the entire performance. And that's why you have to come ready. You have to have that in your head. Otherwise, you're lost. There's no way you can improvise this kind of thing on the spot. So, okay. Next score handles Messiah. I chose one particular number. The reason I'm showing you this score is that this has also the chorus in it. So I want to show you how that looks in the score. So first, let us refresh our memory of what the music that I'm talking about. Hold on. Gonna be right here. Thank you. Okay, so now let me try to get back to the presentation, which I'm not quite sure how to do. How? Okay, here we are. So, now with that music in mind, here's how, and again, we don't unfortunately see any of those signs, barely. You may see something on the top there saying, this is tutti strings. One of the decisions I may have to make, or didn't have to make, but I chose to make, I didn't want to play the entire Messiah with the same string forces. So some I chose that some numbers will be played by only first stands, some will be only played by soloists, some will be played by four violins and two, and some will be played by tutti. All numbers with the chorus, I chose to play with a tutti orchestra. It just made sense because those numbers are big, require big sound. So I reminded myself by writing tutti strings up there. Then I wrote H-A-R-P-S, which means harpsichord, because I also requested that I have a harpsichord and a positive organ, a little organ, which has sort of like a harmonium sound. So for some movements, I chose for that instrument to accompany them. And for more energetic movements, I wanted more immediate and clinky sound. I chose harpsichord. So that's why I had that note there, because I had to tell my keyboardist to switch instruments. Then I also write TR, trumpets. Because trumpets only play in several of numbers of Messiah, so it's important to look at them and just let them know that you're aware of them. So this score is atypical in that the trumpets are above oboes, but that's okay. We deal with that all the time. Then you have strings, but not all of them. First violin, second violin, viola line. Then you have the chorus, glory to God, glory to, again, the music, remember, go glory to God, glory to God, goes like that. And then, see, basses don't sing at this point yet. And then you have basso continuo, which in Baroque music is cello, double bass, bassoon, and the keyboard. And they have the lowest line here. They provide the harmony, the bass line and the harmony. So that's how the score of Messiah looks like. There's the next page. What can you see there or not? You cannot see that there is a T above end piece, and there is a B under it. So that when I flip page, I know instantly that it's tenors and basses singing, not sopranos and altos, because as you can see, it can be pretty confusing. Like, who is that, actually? Who is playing there? Is it trumpets? Is it, And then if I look at it for a second, I know, because I see a viola clef here, right here. So I know that, so these are strings. And this, therefore, must be the chorus. But anyway, you don't have time for that. You flip page, and you want to have that information right away. There is some numbers that you probably don't see here. There is a 6 that was written in the score, and I added 4. And then I added 6 here. I'm adding numbers that represent chords, and we learned this Baroque language, and so this to me indicates that it's a note B, but I'm not going to be hearing a B major or minor chord. I'm going to be hearing the first inversion of G major. So anyway, so I write all kinds of little things that we would be sitting here for several years probably. Now, those trumpets, remember in the beginning they were trumpets? They only played for a few measures, and then they had a rest. So what, again, you unfortunately can't see very well, right here I have TR1, and here I have TR2, and they're circled, because those are important cues that I really have to give, because this is a fugato section where when the voices overlap, and it's easy to get lost. So I do need to bring those instruments in. So I circle them. I also, sometimes you have a symphony and you go for 10 minutes, sometimes you go for 40 minutes before a particular instrument played its first note. And you need to be aware of that. And sometimes it's very prominent as a solo, but sometimes they just sneak in. So imagine, they just sit there forever. So those, I always circle the first entrance of every instrument. When they're already playing and they have few bars off and then they go on, then I don't circle them. But that's again my individual solution that makes it clear to me, and different conductors probably would find slightly different solutions for that. See here I circled this funny thing because the basses have a tenor clef there, or alto clef, I believe that alto clef. So I need to be reading different notes. Then what you don't probably see here, I have chords written out: D major, G major, E minor, A major. So okay. So have you seen the Butterfly production? Recent Butterfly production? Yeah. Thank you. So let me play a little bit of that music and then show you, and we'll see how much we can see of that, how complex that thing is. That's a very, very complex score. So this is from the first act duet, 135. So first I'll give you a little music here. Oh. Listen, don't watch. It's an old recording. You can tell that oboe sounds very nasal. They got so much better in the last 50 years. It's a gorgeous music, isn't it? Puccini is all about, you know, it's not ba 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 bam ba 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 bam 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 bam. It's very fluid. Almost every measure has some kind of a stretch, which we call the rubato, rallentando, or rubato, meaning just the tempo never stays the same. It either speeds up or slows down every measure. It's very difficult and very beautiful when done properly. You are just swimming in this ocean of gorgeous notes. But it would be hard for me, without really knowing the score, to often say where one is. It's written so that it's really just keeps overlapping, right? That's the same with Wagner, for example. We just get into that mass of beautiful sounds and just flow with it. So how does he do that? So here's one page of that score, and now you can see a little more. Let me point on all the signs here. It says clarinet one. Here it says flutes. Here it says piccolo. Here it says tam tam, which is quite important because that tam tam doesn't play much in the opera. Now here's a big number, 8, that you may or may not see, emphasizing that although this measure is in 4, I am going to conduct it in 8 because it's very slow. Do you see these little quetch, 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 quetch things? those are conductor's indications for subdividing beat. So there are four quatches like that. Then there is a little wave like this, which means slow down, a reminder for myself. Then here's a big number six. Here's a crescendo and decrescendo. That was important for me to know. Here's an oboe that said, ba-da-tri-a-ra-ta, responded by clarinet, ba-da-tri-a-ra-ta, responded by flute, da-da-p-tram. And again, you see a little, there's few of those signs. Here, first violins, a big one, Roman numeral one, PN. Here, a letter P, which indicates not piano in this score, but Pinkerton, the character of Pinkerton. He comes very inconspicuously on the end of three, and it's very hard to say. So I marked these beats, one, two, three, just so that I don't cue him somewhere in beat two. Because, see, that weirdly, this part of measure is stretched much more than this one. I mean, that happens all the time. So if you just go visually, you can get very confused. So I had to write these things. I put a little quatch here for the for butterflies line. Then again, some numbers, some subdivisions. You know, sometimes use this part. It was a recorded score, a very good score, but it had text in not in only in Italian but also in German. And sometimes the German had added vowels. So see, I had to scratch one note here and scratch the text because it's confusing because you didn't see two notes, but you only hear one sound. So you make all these minuscule changes. Now see, I don't know, you see a bunch of little signs up there. Some of these measures I conducted. There are six beats to measure. Some of them I conducted one and two and three and the others I conducted one and two and because the music required that. So I had to mark that to remember that. Then a reminder here, you can probably see a big three and big three. The key signature changes when I flip page. So when I flip page and I don't know, it's too late. I already screwed up. So I have to see that ahead of time and give myself an advance warning for what's coming up. And then I reiterated with another three up there. That's here, this kind of sign, this means the tempo is going to be slower than the previous tempo. Again, it's very, very easy to miss this kind of things. Because the music just goes, and there's so much information there. So I had to mark it, and I marked it twice so that I remembered when I'm somewhere over here, I'm thinking already slower tempo and setting up slower tempo. Here I added a fermata, a little sign like that, because it's customary, although not written, that a singer hold this particular note longer. And there millions of these, right? I mean, thousands, I should say. The next page, another page, this is Pinkerton's line, this is Butterfly's line, and then orchestra is above and below. There is an arrow pointing to the right, meaning accelerando, go faster. Again, go faster, and then a little wave, meaning slow down. I circled these two notes because it's very hard to hear, but cellos didn't play for a long time, and I needed to cue them because they were getting lost there. And they actually came to me and asked me, can you give us that particular cue? I said, you bet. So I marked it, and I gave it to them. So that's how we. So again, you don't see all of it, but the point is, this score was 500 pages long. So it gives you an idea of how much time a conductor spends preparing the score before he gets to the orchestra. There are dozens and dozens of hours, and you know, page after page, and you have to. That's the most grueling process. So as I said, the first stage for me personally, I play the score on a piano, which gives me a very good sense of sonorities, and I find mistakes in the scores. Unless the score is super modern and so convoluted that it just doesn't give me any idea when I play it. And then I just skip it. Unfortunately, then all you have is just your ability to look at it and analyze it based on just visually. So after that comes this stage when I sit down and for many, many hours I am going every line of those 500 pages and marking everything so that when I get in front of the orchestra and when I work with the singers, not only I know in broadest sense what kind of expression I want, what kind of tempo I want, but that I am aware of all these little details. And only then I can be of help. Only then I can say, oh, no, those two notes, little faster, please. Or that B flat, little lower. It's only after that preparation that you can really be helpful. Now, there are a few, there are three more scores I want to show you for different reasons. And we will not spend as much time on them. They're all modern scores, and so I want to give you a sense of what that looks like. The first one is Stravinsky, Rite of Spring, a piece that is well known for being full of unpredicted rhythms and not much melody. It's all rhythm. So let's first look at the score, and then we will try to follow it with a video. So here's the... And this score has fewer markings, and it's an older score where I used some different signs. For example, that circle, I don't use that anymore. I use a triangle. And what it tells me, that it measure, which has 9 beats in it, I will conduct 1, 2, well, how do you say it in a human language? I will basically do 4 gestures in a 9-8 measures, but the third gesture will have 3 beats in it, and the previous will have 2. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. But much faster. So I'm actually using a scheme of a 4-4 measure, but but not every beat is of equal length. But I have to remind myself because you have no idea. And there are again many of these, and some of them I will conduct differently. Some of them I will, for musical reasons, have that stretched beat somewhere else in the measure. So I have to make a point, I have to mark that as such. So see the key, the tempo, no, the, sorry, the measure, how do you say, time signatures change a lot here. This is 5-8 for 2 measures, then 9-8, then 5-8, then 7-8. And see what they do? They're marking it here for us, for conductors, so that when we flip the page, we're not surprised. Here's a 7-8, but there's a note that's not showing up here that says, like 5-8 before, just with 2 additional beats. Then here I have something called, I don't know if you can see a note here saying vamp, vamp. This is a 7-4 measure when they play ba, 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 ba. And there he has many measures like this when there's repeated pattern. And I, instead of trying to invent some new conducting schemes, I go 1. And then I go just left and right for as many beats. They don't even have to count. I am the only one counting. I'm counting, and then I give them the last one up. And it's a very elegant solution rather than trying to do this. Again, they only need to hit downbeat, and then they need to know when they move to the next music. So ting, 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 boom. Yeah. And, I mean, the whole process takes probably a second, but you have to make those decisions. Here's another vamp, a new music, new section. Okay, so let's go back, and let us try to. This will probably be about
20 seconds of music that I just showed you. So let's try that. Probably about 15 seconds of music, I think, that we got there on those few pages. So, I apologize. I have a technical problem here. Oh, and I think I just they're gonna make me pay for it. So, two more scores, and then there will be time for questions. It's hard to do this multitasking, I must say. Yes, you need a conductor. So this is the Stravinsky that we just went through. Have you heard of Mr. Crump, an early 20th century, or even late 19th, right? Century composer, very experimental. So look at this kind of score. This is an orchestral score. I'm only gonna give you two pages of it. This is page one. This is page two. So as the music became more complex and more experimental, composers started experimenting with notation too, because the notation, the one reason I have to put so many markings in that in a score is that it's not perfect. What you have there is a sort of a blueprint, and you have to really fill in so many blanks. But frankly, you can only do it by studying for many years and acquire the sense of style and the knowledge about the style. And so this is very difficult, because every composer of this avant-garde music will have his own system. So before I even start putting those signs in, I will spend multiple hours decoding what this is about. And then after I'm done with that, and then I do all my regular work, then we perform it, and it's probably a 5-minute long piece. I mean, in this case, it's more like 20 minutes, but it's a lot of effort. And then you know what? I'm not going to even play it for you, because you're not going to like it. So, last but not least, it's very interesting from his historic perspective. I'll give you that. Last but not least, Yoshimatsu Cyberbird Concerto that we just did. Oh, thanks. It was a fun piece for you. So this is how it looked for me. The challenge with this score is not so much that it is fairly modern. You know, I think I have only two pages here, this one and this one, see? And I have notes up there, stop beating, count eight measures, then show subito piano, show crescendo. The main challenge with this score was that I could not read it. It's a horrible copy. And the musicians had the same problem. And this was literally anyway, I'm not going to go into details. So this is another challenge that we're facing. You know, you often choose an edition as a conductor. You choose an edition that you want to work with, and they all are differently priced. Some of them you can buy, some of them you only can rent, and the rent will be expensive because everyone knows it's a good edition. So we're running into all these problems with this particular piece. There is only this copy, and I really wanted to do it. And the agent whom we communicated with, actually our librarian, Scott Miller, right there, I mean, he lost his hair over it. He was an extremely unreliable person. And it was horrible to communicate with. And then he sent us this kind of material that we just, it was so difficult to decode what's actually in it. There are even few pages that I realized, oh my God, there are missing bars. I had 3 missing bars and I had 2 missing bars. So I had to figure it out and write it out. So that's another challenge in score preparation. That's it. Okay. Questions? Thank you. I am very happy that I was able, at least you saw at least a tiny bit of what it is in terms of the score preparation, what goes into it before we even come in front of the orchestra.
Martin, would you repeat the questions so we'll get...
I will repeat the questions, yes. Joel. I do not, because I am required to be equally passionate about every piece that I present. It's in my contract. Now, the fact is there are composers that I am very passionate about, but they change all the time. And I always am looking for, and they, sometimes they just speak to you in a particular moment of your life. There are certain stalwarts, you know, of course, you know, you can listen to Beethoven and Brahms over and over, and it's always going to be gorgeous. But I'm a big fan of Béla Bartók, for example. We're going to do a piece by his finally next year. The reason I waited for so long is not so much musical as it is that, again, we can only get his music as a rental, and we only can get, and it's very expensive. And there is only one agency, Boosey and Hawks, that. Because they have the monopoly, they can set up prices really high. They will not allow you to buy that music because they want to keep renting it to you. And so you end up paying a lot of money for a short piece of music. So it's unfortunate. But I had to wait until I felt like I can make that request to my board to support me and you know, and present it to you. So there's all kinds of little things that go into it. Yes, sir. Yeah, how do you keep track of all the? Well, as I said, I mean, it's, you know, I've been studying music since I was a kid, but then I went to a conservatory when I was 14, and so it took me, you know, almost 20 years to sort of get some hang on it. And there's a lot of, you know, we are passionate about what we do, and there are lots of nerds among us that don't do anything else but music, which I don't necessarily like, but... Yeah, does that answer your question? Or you mean in particular, how do you keep the music here? I believe that brain has amazing capabilities. So I think it just, it makes, it finds its space there. And you can just... Yes.
Yeah, probably the soloists come in with preconceived notions as to what they think they're supposed to be.
Yes, the question was, do you have problem with soloists who, well, first of all, we do agree ahead of time what they will be performing, and if I don't like it, I either get a different soloist or I change the rest of my program to fit his demands. Because I want them to play what they like to play, but I also, you know, you sometimes choose a person and you want them to play a piece that their website says they have in the repertoire, and then you talk to them and they say, well, I don't feel it this, you know, this decade, it's just not my thing. And so in terms of actual, you know, coming and being a diva and all that, we get very little of that. And if you do, the word spreads around. And there's so much good quality musicians that they will not be asked back. That's the reality. So most of them are very nice and go out of their way to accommodate you. Yes.
That the upbeat seems to be the downbeat with some with some directors, and I was wondering whether that's just the reaction of the delayed reaction of the orchestra, or whether some actually do the upbeat, meaning that's where we start here.
It's a great question. Great question, and I think it's both. Part of it just seems that sometimes it seems like that goes up instead of going down, and it's an illusion because of that delay that goes that's happening with the orchestra. But sometimes you see conductors starting putting more emphasis on the upbeat, which is not a good sign of a conducting technique usually. But I would judge it on an individual basis. But I use it when I want my orchestra to pick up the tempo. When I go like this in steady tempo. Now, if I want them to go a little faster, I change the ictus, the emphasis, from down to up. So it goes like this. See? I mean, there's little nervousness there. And that propels them, and they know what that means. Now, when you're a conductor, and I know of many people, well, and a few, who are actually accomplished and would just do that all the time, players really suffer because they're getting mixed messages. They're getting a message saying, speed up, hurry up. But at the same time, they know that they're required to keep the tempo steady. So it's very confusing, and it just throws you out of music when you do that. So it has its role. But anyway, I hope it's a very complex problem. So thank you for that. I think there was a hand there.
Well, first of all, I wanted to say thank you. I've taken you for granted and people like you for years. I had no idea of the complexity, and it's been a wonderful presentation. And I'm just curious, what drew you to the Rogue Valley?
I was looking for a music directorship for a job, and this came up, and this particular one spoke to me. Frankly, I'm not yet so. I don't know the United States so well, so I consulted with friends that I trusted in Tucson, Arizona. They said, "Oh, Rogue Valley, yeah, Ashland, yes, go for it." So there was one element, but also it was the size of the orchestra, the budget, all these things. I thought that, okay, I think this would be a good match, and I think I would have a good chance. So that's how I ended up here. Yes, sir.
I know sometimes you conduct with just your hands, and sometimes you use a baton. I'm able to figure out why. But what's your choice in doing that?
So, me particularly?
Yeah.
Yes. I usually use a baton. The reason we use a baton, which, by the way, I brought with me so that you can see it. I forgot. The baton extends my hand and makes things easier to see. So when I this is my baton, and we could probably don't have time to talk about different batons, but when I do this kind of movement, see, I mean, if you people in the last row, that's how much you see. When I do the same with the baton, it just really extends everything. So it helps the coordination. Now, why do I choose sometimes not to have the baton? I do it when the texture of music is more choral-like, more homophonic, and when I want the sound to be very round and without edges. So then I would do this, say in a very slow movement that doesn't have any in it, but just big chords. It just gives a better expression of the music. So I chose it based just on that. Yes?
You mark up your score so lovingly, and then you conduct very often without your score.
Yeah.
Does that mean that you memorize the scores, the markings, the whole package?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. That's the... Well, I buy my scores as much as I can.
Okay.
And when we rent a score, and I don't know if this is actually legal, but I can't I can't help. We do rent, so it's not illegal to not use it as long as you pay. But I have my own copy where I put all my notes, because I mean I spent so much time, and plus you are required to return the clean copy. So forget about using red pencil. It just makes everything so difficult. So I'll make my own copy. I'll try to, you know, mark everything. I memorize it. The clean score goes back. And we again, when we do it next time, I will again rent it, but I will use my score. Yeah. I use Sprint Fast in Ashland. They're very nice. They know me now. Yes.
Once you've invested the time and effort to develop a score, a piece, and how you're going to conduct it, do you try to do that same piece repeatedly when you're guest conducting?
See, that's very interesting, because that you would think so. That would make sense. I don't. I have to tell you, I hate repeating things. There's so much great music. So there are certain things that I feel I should do here in Rogue Valley. One of them, for example, is the New World Symphony by Dvořák. And the reason I haven't done it yet is that I conducted it so many times in the past that I just don't want to do it. But I want to do it for you, and I can do it. I think I can do it well, because I grew up with that music. And I did it with orchestras in Central Europe that played Dvořák with their eyes closed. So I probably have good things to say about the symphony. I just have to bring myself to do it. So, I think as my life will get more busier and busier, I will start relying more and more on these things that I study so meticulously now. Yes?
Could you tell us how you proceed to memorize? Do you do it from a recording, or do you do it from playing the piano over and over? How do you do it?
You do everything you can, so you use all possible tools. But and I do listen to recordings as well. But ultimately, it's just me sitting in my chair and staring at the pages until they stare back at me. Even my mom, who knows me well, she was so surprised. She visited me here last summer. And she saw me for hours, and you know, it's very easy to get an impression. You have to have a very tolerant partner, because it seems like I'm not doing anything. I'm just sitting there for hours, just flipping pages in quiet, and it plays in my head. I mean, I try to make it play in my head. And then you come to the orchestra, and all of a sudden, you said, wow, I had no idea. But there is many, many hours of that, just staring at it. And that's why, for me, it's important to have all those notes, because they are reminders for my brain, and they get imprinted in my brain. Without them, I tried studying scores without marking anything, and I could not retain as much information as I can with those notes. Yeah. Yes, please.
Once you have your annotated score, do your musicians get that copy, and do you hear them in their practice sessions, like the strings practice or the woodwind practice, so that they know the feeling that you want to put into that?
Yes. Well, what I do here in particular, in this particular situation, I send my orchestra notes along with the schedule. It usually contain recordings. Now, this is wonderful that we have these new tools like YouTube, so I can find a recording that sort of is close to what I want to do. And then I give them tempo markings. I alert them to things that may be ambiguous. You know, many of these things, they're trained musicians, so many of these things they know, and they will come to the same conclusions as I do. But sometimes there are different ways to do a particular passage, so I will address that. So, and then we, of course, have rehearsals, and we have a string sectional rehearsal, so many of these things get addressed. But just writing all this information to everybody's score would take just an amazing amount of time, so I don't do that. Yes, please.
When you're a guest conductor, how long do you have to practice with musicians?
It usually happens within a week. Professional orchestras rehearse Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then Thursday there's a dress rehearsal and a concert either Thursday or Thursday and Friday night, sometimes Saturday. But you fly in on weekend and you leave next weekend. It's very intense. And rehearsals in Europe are longer than they are in the United States. So, yes, please.
Before you became director of the OLLI Symphony, your colleague Ed White used to give talks before a concert in a small room on the second floor of the building to a very small number of people. You've done something radically different. You come at 6:30 with your soloist at the concert hall. You speak to a very large group of people, you introduce the soloist, and you give a very good preview of what the concert is going to be about. And I urge all people who have tickets to come at 6:30 and hear you introduce the soloist and talk about him or her, and then give the audience a preview of what the concert is. It really enriches the whole concert.
Well, thank you very much. I personally, when I go to a concert of New York Philharmonic or San Francisco, I try to go to pre-concert talks because I always learn something new. And I think it's good if a conductor does that job himself, not because necessarily we know more, but you know how I want to do it. And it makes just more sense that way. So thank you. And then another thing is I don't like talking from stage. Because that irritates me, and I know other people have different preferences, but when I go to a concert and I hear talks and I'm being educated on those pieces, that's not what I paid for. So that's why I may sometimes in the future, there may be a reason for me to turn and explain maybe if the piece is very complicated, but overall, come to a pre-concert talk if you want to hear more, and come to a concert if you only want to hear music. Yes, please.
For the opera, how many rehearsals do you have? Are all your rehearsals with the singers and the orchestra, or do you rehearse separately with the orchestra?
Opera is so complex, and it's a long process. It takes several weeks. It takes about 3 weeks. Sometimes it takes a month. And it starts with staging rehearsals, which is rehearsals with all singers. Instead of orchestra, we have an accompanist. And the conductor's there, and the director is there. And these rehearsals, they're usually 2 to 3 a day. So you spend 6-8 hours a day in staging rehearsals, and you put the opera together. And while that is happening, I start towards the end of that period rehearsing with the orchestra by itself. And then we combine it, and then we have a rehearsal in a sort of like in a concert situation. And then we get to the theater and rehearse in the theater with the movement and everything. So it's a multi-stage process, but it always starts with several weeks of rehearsing just with singers, conductor, director, and the accompanist. I think we have time for one more question. Yes, please.
Do you have an opinion about special concerts for children?
I think they're very valuable. There are many different tools, though, and how to approach young people. And the trend now is to support, by grants, support more active involvement of children. So we still have our group of players that go around the school and present programs for kids. I would love to go back to those concerts with kids. They do become an expensive endeavor for us. We don't have a really good coverage for that because the grantors are not interested in supporting that kind of thing. But the big news of the big project that we have next year, starting next year, we're going to be sending our musicians to schools in Talent Phoenix School District that doesn't have any music education on elementary level. And we'll be providing music education. So it's the hands-on approach. And we will have, if things go as planned, and they will, in 3 years, there will be 600 kids that had no exposure to music. And they will be able to play an instrument. And they will be playing with the symphony. We will have, every year, we'll have a concert with these kids. Well, thank you very much.
Absolutely wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Oh my.
I have a bad news for you. Look what happened here. I hope they'll be able to fix it.
Yes, nice to meet you.